Hi everyone, this is Laura,
Megan,
Mia,
Lupita,
and Chelsea
on Crazy Talk with College Freshmen. On today's podcast, we're going to be talking about how mental illness was perceived during medieval times, specifically around literary figures Margery Kempe and the wife of Bath. Now let's jump into some background information on these subjects.
Psychology was only recently reformed so that treatment and diagnosis of patients would be humane and specific to each of them. Throughout time, many mentally ill people have been misdiagnosed and treated, well, pretty terribly.
Some points of history have been notorious for their brutal treatments of mentally ill patients. As recently as the 20th century, doctors were still performing lobotomies and continued to put patients through electroshock therapy, many of whom were not even ill. Additionally, patients were often confined to disturbing conditions found in mental asylums. However, perceptions of those struggling with mental illness in medieval times were quite different, and we will take a closer look at that today. Now let's discuss Margery Kempe.
So, Margery was born in 1373. She was the daughter of the town's mayor, so she was relatively upper class, and she had her life transcribed for her in an autobiography, which was common then, since women couldn't typically read or write. And for her, this autobiography was really a tale of her religious journey through life. Her relationship with her husband was sort of transactional and economical, as we'll see later as I'm sort of talking about her story. She had 14 children with him, and childbirth is really where Margery's sort of emotional and religious journey begins. Margery really details how much trouble she had with childbirth, she says, and after she conceived, she was troubled by severe illness until the child was born, and then on account of the trouble she had in childbirth and the illness before, she despaired of her life, thinking she might not live. So she's very depressed, is going through an experience that she doesn't quite understand. She talks about how she felt like a terrible sinner, like the devil was talking to her, she says. And day and night during this time, she thought she saw devils with open mouths, all aflame, with burning waves of fire as though they would swallow her, sometimes raging at her, sometimes threatening her, sometimes pulling her and grabbing her. And the devils cried out dire threats and demanded that she forsake her Christianity and her faith and deny her God. So she's having very deep visual and audible real experiences. She's seeing the devil, she's interpreting her negative traumatic experiences religiously. And in Roy Porter's article, Margery Kempe and the Meaning of Madness, he explains why Margery is so significant in history. He writes, "Medieval and early modern women commonly underwent mental trauma, yet infrequently left accounts of it. Therein lies the unique interest of Margery Kempe's life story, for not only did she record her experiences in great detail, but was able to make sense of them during her bouts and in their aftermath, though not in terms of being a madwoman, but through the idiom of the Christian life of the spirit." And this is a theme we see all throughout Margery's life. And then Margery experiences salvation. She literally sees Jesus come down from the heavens, and she, quote, "actually saw the sky open like a flash of lightning, and he climbed back up into the air, not too quickly or hastily, but gracefully and easily, so that she could see him in the sky until it closed." And then immediately after this, she describes herself as having returned to being sound in her wits and reason as she had never been before. So this sort of miraculous recovery sort of sounds ridiculous in the context of psychological and mental illness today, but then for her it was very real. What do you guys think?
Well, medieval priests and medieval doctors would have had very conflicting viewpoints about Margery Kempe's condition. Medieval and early modern Europeans regarded the mentally ill either as cursed by witches or as possessed by devils, so the church wouldn't have seen Kempe as mentally ill, but simply as possessed by some evil force. Possessed individuals were most likely to have low status or to be women in a male-dominated society. Priests took note of several striking characteristics, one of which was that the patient's body appeared to be invaded by a new personality. Sometimes their voice would deepen, making them sound very different, and they often suffered from powerful, distorted body movement. When assessing a supposedly possessed patient, priests would take note that the thoughts expressed by the new personality are quite different from those of the old one, and these episodes of possession were often succeeded by amnesia. Schizophrenia was most often linked to possession, yet the disorder sharing the most common symptoms is probably Tourette's syndrome, which is also rare and characterized by involuntary tics and compulsive utterance of obscenities. Pope Gelasius in the 5th century prohibited epileptics from receiving holy orders on the ground that epileptic seizures arose from demonic possession.
Actually, this is where the contradiction arises. Jerome Kroll and Bernard Bachrach wrote an article entitled Sin and Mental Illness in the Middle Ages, they highlight the fact that there's a lot of misconceptions about how people diagnosed mental illness in the Middle Ages. One of the biggest misconceptions is that it was attributed to supernatural or demonic powers. They wrote about how people who wrote about mental illness would recognize that there was a difference between natural and supernatural reasons. Some accounts will say that a priest cured a person of a demonic possession, and then later say that they also cured a person of epilepsy. So there was an obvious distinction between the two. Their article also goes on to say that cases were hardly attributed to demons or God. If they were attributed to God, it was mostly for a selfish reason, meaning that, let's say a person was being really rude about a patron saint, saying that they weren't actually helpful or they weren't real, then another writer would go on to say God struck them deaf and dumb. So it was more of a revenge technique. In the Middle Ages, people, especially in England, would get tested for incompetency. Physicians, officials, and the kings were in charge of diagnosing people, and they would ask questions mostly about computing math and basic monetary values. They'd also be tested on their memory and just general awareness questions like if they knew their name or if they knew who brought them there. Usually a diagnosis would be between two different incompetencies, and Richard Naugbauer describes these as a natural fool or a non compos mentis. Margery of Kempe might have been a non compos mentis because a non compos mentis was somebody who developed their mental illness later in life. Her visions and ideas take over later after the traumatic births of her children.
Well, I'm wondering how medieval doctors and priests would have viewed Margery's perceived salvation, because following it, she became this very pious woman. She returned to what we would consider quote unquote normal behavior and became newly devoted to Christianity. She fasted, she wanted to go on pilgrimages and be chaste. However, her husband wouldn't allow her, and she eventually had to negotiate out this settlement with him where she would pay off all of his debts in exchange for what she wanted. And it's sort of interesting to note that when she asks God if the terms of the agreement that she's negotiated with him are acceptable in his eyes, she believes that he told her it was all right. So you have to wonder how people in medieval times would have reacted to her sort of supposed communication with God, and whether or not they thought she was just making it up so that she could get what she wanted. She also had this strange fixation with the passions, which really manifests on her pilgrimage to Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, she had what she describes as spiritual sights, where she sees scenes and images of the crucifixion, of Mary Magdalene, of St. John, and these are very emotional, spiritual experiences for her. And for the rest of her life, she has these terribly dramatic crying fits. They're described as spiritual sights that cause the creature to weep, to sob, and to cry so loudly that she could not control it or restrain herself. While this was happening, her body would sort of twist and contort as well. And I think it's particularly interesting to note that it would often occur during sermons, which greatly irritated the preaching monks and archbishops, as they felt she was competing with them. And whether or not she was in a competition with them is still sort of debated today. In Jessica Rosenfeld's paper, Envy and Exemplarity, in the book of Margery Kempe, she writes, "There is a widespread disagreement among contemporary scholars that Margery Kempe's book represents a distinctly competitive example of religious devotion. She is understood to be competing with the clerks who question her practices, and even more markedly, to be competing with the saints whom she models herself." And you almost get a sense of this competition when she interacts with the monks after she is accused of being a heretic. During her trial, she tells this story where she is actually making fun of them during her interview and makes it appear as though she is more devoted to God and has a closer relationship with him than anyone else. But whether or not she was actively trying to compete with other people, this sort of perceived competitiveness, or even just the strangeness of these crying fits, really ostracized her from those around her.
Well, it would have been common for them to ostracize her, but physicians also would have continued diagnosing her as non compos mentis because, as Richard Naugbauer says, persons non compos mentis might experience periods of temporary remission, lucid intervals, or they would recover completely. And we see this with Margery, as every time they talk about Jesus's torture or during the crucifixion, she has these fits and she's triggered into crying and just twisting around. And it would have shown physicians that she truly was mentally ill and that she needed to be cared for. And so kings and officials would have appointed her some type of a caretaker. And we do get a glimpse of her having caretakers when she mentions that after the birth of her first child, she sees Jesus and there are no other caretakers watching her. We don't know for sure if these caretakers were for mentally ill people, but she is left in the hands of her family, which was common for the time as well.
So what would medieval priests have thought?
Religious authorities have articulated diverse positions on Margery Kempe's spirituality. Though she encountered resistance from numerous churchmen, she was able to find others who supported her. Some of the groups or individuals she traveled with in her narrative recognize her spiritual gifts, while others reject her. Even her husband is supportive at times, and resistant to her devotional goals on other occasions. From a biblical standpoint, authoritative interpretation of Margery Kempe's crying fits can only be found by attributing them to her visionary conversations with Christ. There, Christ reassures Margery that the tears she cries are from the eyes of God. The tears resolve the paradoxes of Margery's social identities into a unified relationship with Christ. And Margery Kempe's access to divine assistance provides her with a strong sense that she can become her own spiritual interpreter, despite external harassment and skepticism from other clerics.
We've been talking a lot about Margery Kempe, so why don't we go ahead and get into the Wife of Bath story.
The story of Wife of Bath is a tale with a prologue. The prologue is monologue by Wife of Bath. She gives basic information about herself and offers her unique ideas on women, which is quite different from the general ideas people had in medieval times. The story is about a knight being asked by a queen to find out what women truly desire. In the end, the knight finds out that what women really want is actually the power to control their own fate. Unlike other women in medieval time, Wife of Bath has been married for 5 times. Being married for more than one time was extremely rare around that time, especially as mentioned in Wife of Bath prologue, that Jesus only attended a single wedding up in Galilee. And this example is that should truly teach me that I should not be married more than once. And here are beating words that Christ pronounced beside a well Jesus, both God and man, speaking to a woman, a Samaritan. "You've had 5 husbands," he said, scolding the lady. "So the man who has you today, I tell you, is surely not your husband." People in medieval times would definitely perceive Wife of Bath as a whore, for most women only get married for one time only, and would not even consider to get remarried even their husbands die. Divorcing and getting remarried is quite common in our modern world. It is even more reasonable to get remarried if one's husband dies, so her idea should be seen as normal in our modern days. The reason Wife of Bath thinks women should be able to get married for more than one time, just like she does, is because King Solomon has been married for more than one time. Wife of Bath claims that, "Here the wise old king named Solomon, I guess he married a lot more times than once. I wish God would make it legal for me." Wife of Bath compares herself to a man. From this comparison, our readers can tell that Wife of Bath sees women are equal to men, and women should be able to do the same things men can do, and have the same rights as men do. This idea in the medieval time is viewed as crazy for a reason that men were viewed as superior to women. In modern days, not only in our common sense, but also according to the law, women are equal and have the same rights as men do. Wife of Bath desires dominance and power over men. She ruled her husbands as she mentioned in the prologue. "I ruled so hard and kept them under my thumb. She would reward them if they treat her nicely, and in the same way, she would punish them if they treat her poorly." In Wife of Bath's view, husbands are there to make her happy. Her wanting for power is possibly seen as ridiculous in the medieval time because, as mentioned earlier, women were not even equal to men. Women were there to serve men, which is entirely opposite from Wife of Bath's idea. Now, women are definitely equal to men. It is also commonly seen in some cases that women rule over men. In modern days, her idea should not seem as crazy as in the medieval time. In the story Wife of Bath tells, when the queen demands the knight to find out what women truly want, after the knight finds the answer, he replies the queen in the story that what women want most usually is sovereign power in their hands, not only over husbands but whatever love first they take. They wish to be masters, high above them. From the story she tells, Wife of Bath is a very power-thirsty woman who also desires freedom. Additionally, Wife of Bath asserts in the prologue that, "No matter what you think, you will not be master of my body and my property." Furthermore, she says, "Women don't love a man who watches so closely. We need to be free. We need to make our own decisions." In the medieval time, freedom and being able to make own decisions never belonged to women. Women were seen as properties of men who were not supposed to have their own emotions, feelings, and freedom. Nowadays, women are seen as individuals instead of properties which belong to men. Women have all the freedom of making their own decisions and controlling their own lives.
From my research and from the sound of it, a physician in medieval times would not have actually thought the wife of Bath was crazy. She wasn't throwing any type of fits, and she also seemed to be very well aware of her surroundings. She went on pilgrimages a lot with others.
But priests from the medieval era would have believed the wife of Bath was a heretic because of her perceived promiscuity and multiple marriages. Many priests would have believed her to be doing the devil's work. If she would have tried to spread her views, she might have been severely punished or even killed by the church.
So we really talked about how medieval psychologists would have seen Margery Kempe and the wife of Bath. So why don't we get a more modern perspective? And Mia, can you explain how we got from the medieval perspective to the more modern day scientific sort of biological perspective?
The first sort of mention of biological psychology came surprisingly early. In the 5th century BC, Hippocrates, who was a renowned Greek physician, first conceived of a more clinical approach to psychology. He posited that mental health focused on a theory of four bodily humors: phlegm, blood, black bile, and yellow bile. Hippocrates thought that the equilibrium of these humors, which he believed to be the building blocks of personality, were central to mental health, and if one was off balance, they would essentially create a negative change in personality. While obviously a rudimentary analysis of mental health, Hippocrates is one that paved the way for modern scientists. But that development didn't come quickly. It wasn't until 1953 that the phrase biological psychiatry was used in an attempt to explain mental illness as a function of the nervous system, drawing on a number of other biological disciplines, like biochemistry and psychopharmacology, in that explanation. This marks a decided change from the way psychology was viewed during medieval times, like in the way that Margery Kempe was regarded by herself and others. While she believed that her experience was truly a religious one, and others believed that she was possessed by a demonic presence, a more modern explanation would take a much more scientific and biological approach. And this makes total sense. For Margery and those who lived during medieval times, religion was everything. It was faith and science. One can only really make sense of their life through their specific purview, something that is intrinsically related to societal structure or belief. So, if Margery had lived during the modern era rather than attribute her actions to a connection with God or inhabitation by demons, one would most likely bring her to a doctor who might diagnose her with a mental illness. In analyzing her symptoms through our modern context, they now seem more in line with a kind of extreme postpartum depression called postpartum psychosis, which is typically brought on by difficult childbirth. Today, the condition is treated as a very serious psychiatric emergency, one that affects 1 to 2 women per 1,000 in the first couple of weeks following childbirth. Symptoms often include visual, auditory, and olfactory hallucinations, as Margery Kempe did. Postpartum depression wasn't recognized until the 19th century as a disorder, and even then was not treated in the manner that it would have been today. In the 20th century, many women who experienced depression would not seek help or admit to their symptoms for fear of being diagnosed as neurotic, and subsequently having to undergo a variety of unusual and often unsavory treatments, like electroshock therapy, which was the recommended treatment for neurotic women in the 1950s. Today, if a woman were to exhibit signs of postpartum psychosis, as Margery Kempe did, she would most likely be prescribed a combination of antipsychotic, antidepressant, mood stabilizing, or sleep medications. Beyond this, outpatient support is recommended for women suffering postpartum psychosis, as is regular exercise and activities with their child or children. Considering the difference between a medieval opinion of Margery Kempe and a modern one provides a very stark and interesting look at the way medicine, particularly psychology and psychiatry, has evolved. Although it took a substantial amount of time to develop Hippocrates' ideas in the 5th century BC to those in 2016, the progression has been tremendous and should continue to grow both in the Western world and elsewhere in coming years.
So you've talked a lot about Margery Kempe's diagnosis and how we got to modern scientific versions of psychology, but what do you think of the wife of Bath? From what Chaucer said, it sort of sounds like she didn't have any mental health issues.
In analyzing the wife of Bath's character now, she doesn't appear crazy or influenced by an unholy entity, as she might have been judged during medieval times. She more aptly comes across as an independent woman with independent thoughts about sexuality, marriage, and religion. thoughts which perhaps were ahead of her time. Rather than condemned, it seems one could assume that today she would be celebrated for living her life according to no one's rules but her own.
I think that after this, we can come to a consensus that Margery Kempe would have been treated worse by the community around her than the physicians and officials who would examine her. It's nice to see that even though the medieval diagnosis was limited, today's medicine has evolved to include much more analysis and types of mental illness. This way, patients get a proper treatment.
Today, the views of the medieval church on Margery Kempe and the wife of Bath would be considered bigoted and disrespectful. Thankfully, mentally ill patients are now treated significantly better by medical doctors, psychologists, and religious figures since psychology has become better understood.
Although ultimately different in modern interpretation, both Margery Kempe and the wife of Bath show the way in which our perception of psychology has evolved. Margery Kempe in the way we identify and treat mental illness, and the wife of Bath in how we view female independence as a cause for celebration rather than condemnation.
Both Margery Kempe and the wife of Bath were subjected to gender discrimination in the ways that they moved through the world, though both found ways to subvert it. Margery negotiated terms with her husband to live the lifestyle she wanted, and the wife of Bath sought autonomy and power in her household. While Margery likely did have a true psychological condition, both were subjected to ostracization from society.
It is interesting to see how people's views on women have changed over time. However, in today's society, even though there are laws enforcing gender equality, there are also times men and women are not equal. Gender equality is still something we need to work on.
That's all for today on Crazy Talk. Catch you next time!